All right, we're back from commercial now, and we're here with David Eisenbach and Ray Rogers. So when we left, we were talking about what?
Small business job survival act?
Yeah, so we have this public hearing, and this is the moment. This is the moment where New York can finally stand up and say to Rebney, enough's enough, all right? You've won every battle on every rezoning, all right? But now we are going to take the city back, right? So if you believe in that, then you got to come out for our rally at 12 noon on October 22nd, Monday. Stand up for SBJSA. We can win this fight, and then that's going to be the beginning of a big coalition to take back the city from the real estate interests.
Yeah. And really, you were talking about the politicians backing you.
Right. We have, I think I had about 70 people that, but either they're incumbents or they ran for either city council or the state legislature and even Congress. And we have a number of these people on our website holding up a brochure rebuking Rebney. Well, one of the things when we took the photos of these candidates and incumbents, we made it clear, win or lose the election, we want to keep your image up there holding up this brochure. Why? You have a following, you stand for something, you had the courage to stand up against the Real Estate Board of New York that is doing so much harm in the city. And when we talk about Rebney, well, what does the acronym Rebney really stand for? The real estate bullies of New York ravaging every borough of New York City. And Rebney's policies are at the root cause of political corruption in New York City. They're at the root, they're the problem when it comes to upzoning and spot zoning. And what's caused from the spot zoning and rezoning is the massive displacement, the exacerbating the homelessness crisis, the lack of affordable housing. When we talk about the small businesses, thousands of small businesses are disappearing in this city. Why? It's because of Rebney's policies and Rebney's for 32 years not allowing the Small Business Job Survival Act to be passed. Again, the only thing that will protect small businesses in this city. And then we have the alarming issue of construction worker fatalities. Again, this is a serious problem from resulting from Rebney's policies of fighting every step of the way legislation that really will protect, you know, construction workers on the job. I know that the figures in 2015-16, 29 out of 31 construction workers that were killed in New York City were on non-union jobs.
I'm running for public advocate as the anti-Rebney candidate. Now, you're not going to find many politicians in New York saying they are anti-Rebney and very proud of it, because I understand, like Ray, and that's why we're partners in this fight, that when you look at so many of the problems around New York City, the fatalities on the job and the unsafe working conditions of construction workers, the small business crisis, the homeless crisis, the displacement crisis, the political corruption, you see Rebney is behind it. And that's why when we have this special election for a public advocate, we need New York to come up and stand behind me, because I'm the one who's going to be actually fighting for you in City Hall against Rebney. All these other politicians, all these other so-called progressives that pretend to be on the side of the people, but when it comes to push come to shove on the zoning, rezoning votes, right, they will sell out the public every step of the way. We need an independent public advocate.
Let's think about who's running Rebney. Look at this banner here. Rebney is run by a bunch of bullies and racketeers, billionaire bullies and racketeers. They're all very rich white men for the most part. You have a few woman, white woman thrown in there as well. But it's really run by this group of rich, very rich billionaires, white men. They do have one African American though. He's the president, John Banks. Now he's not a billionaire. He only gets paid a little more than $800,000 a year to go out and promote Rebney's policies that are doing so much harm, you know, to New Yorkers.
Well, let's also be clear, right? Every community has sellouts. Sellouts come in every color. And they sell out for the one color, and that is green, right? So, you know, let's, you know, make sure that we understand who's the true enemy here. It's not one community against another, one group against each other, right? That's what Rebney wants us to fight. They want us to fight each other. Well, we're going to stand up and say, no, we're not falling for that anymore.
Right, and let's just talk about who these people are when we talk about the billionaire bullies and racketeers. Up until the beginning of this year, Rob Spire, okay, the head of Tishman Spire, he was the chair of Rebney for 5 years. Now, since then, Bill Rudin has taken over. But Rob Spire and Jerry Spire, his father, who had also been the head of Rebney at one time, they should have been in prison. Why? Just simply how they try to cheat all the people at Stuyvesant Town, raising the rents, trying to get rid of the rent-stabilized apartments, etc. But, I mean, they're involved in so much what we could call corrupt activities. They should have been in jail. I'll give you a good example. They got a $200 million tax abatement to provide affordable housing in three towers they're building in Long Island City. As reported in a publication, because of a loophole in the law, they're going to keep the $200 million tax abatement, but they're not providing any affordable housing. Now, let's take a look at who's the chair of Rebney now. It's Bill Rudin. Bill Rudin is the guy that turned St. Vincent's Hospital into a billion-dollar condo. Just what the city needs, another billion-dollar condo.
And by the way, in cahoots with Christine Quinn, right, who made that all possible, and now she wants to run for public advocate? You want somebody who sold out to Rebney to be the public advocate to get rid of a hospital?
Well, the Long Island College Hospital, in my mind, because I live in the neighborhood and that's what started me doing what I'm doing now, is de Blasio, as public advocate, used it to become mayor.
That's right. And one of the first things he did is he flip-flopped and he sold out the hospital.
All right.
Well, I'll tell you, if we go back to the Small Business Job Survival Act, when de Blasio was public advocate, he fully supported the Small Business Job Survival Act. Margarita Viverito, when she was a city council member, she totally supported it. Once he became mayor and she became speaker, they never allowed it to come to a hearing or obviously no vote.
Right. Okay. Well, the Warehousing Act was on the books for what, 3 years before they even voted on it because of her.
But I'll tell you, I challenged her a couple of times. She was very upset because I raised the issue of all the money that she got from the real estate interest. She says, no, that wouldn't have any impact on how I vote. Don't tell me that,
please.
Okay. Then when I questioned her on why did you never allow the Small Business Job Survival Act to even come to a hearing, let alone a vote? Oh, no, we had a hearing. How could she tell me you had a hearing? No, you didn't. You never had a hearing. Right? She lied. She came to my front door when she was rocking around with Diana Aiella, who was her hand-picked successor, you know, to become, she's now a member of the city council. She won the last election, right? And I'm holding all this literature supporting another candidate. And I told her, I said, look, Diana's maybe a fine person, but Margarita, I got a real problem with you. And I started raising these issues. And again, Rebney's money, their dirty money in politics, it doesn't matter who gets elected as long as Rebney exists. So one of the things about the campaign to stop Rebney bullies, okay, is that we want to literally put Rebney out of business. Now that may sound like, wait a minute, you could never do that. Oh yes, we can. There are a couple of things happening. One, the campaign, and we're going to need some real finance. And basically, the finance in this campaign has been me financially, okay? And I'm not rich, but I've put over a couple hundred thousand dollars in this and hundreds of thousands more in terms of time, in terms of working on it, myself and people that work for me and with me, okay? But we could greatly diminish Rebney's political dominance over New York City and New York State politics. If Rebney's going to continue to exist, they should only exist for one reason. To work with the brokers, the agents and brokers of these big brokerage firms, all right, which makes up about 80% of Rebney's membership, buying and selling and renting properties. That's the business they should be in. Get your dirty money out of politics. I might also add that these agents, when you ask any of these agents, and I've talked to dozens of them, every one of them says to me, we hate Rebney. Well, why do you hate Rebney? For two reasons. One, we pay them a lot of dues money and we don't get anything for our money. But number two, the policies that our money is supporting, that what you call, Ray, the billionaire bullies and racketeers, they're setting policies that are destroying our neighborhoods, destroying our communities, pricing myself, my family, my friends, right out of New York City.
And just to emphasize that, the majority of members of Rebney are agents, are real estate agents, not the big guys. But yet, Rebney's policy of stopping the Small Business Job Survival Act is directly hurting the agents. Agents make money by renting out spaces to small businesses. They don't make any money if the space remains empty for years. This is what Douglas Elliman was complaining about when we saw the increase from just 6% vacancy rate of small storefronts to, in 2 years later, 20%.
Yeah, you've got brokers actually that are out there complaining. Some of these brokerage firms, I know up in Inwood, the firm up there was saying, look, we got a real problem with what's going on. You talk about small business being priced out of the market, nobody's renting. We're losing business, just what David was just saying.
This is part of the bigger crisis of the crisis of the middle class. That it's the big players, the billionaires, the 1% that are totally squeezing us and destroying the city that we love.
Right. Well, it's like Engels wrote in 1872, it's the system. You know, we can complain about, you know, money going into politics and everything, but it's the capitalist system that is just at the point where it's screwing everybody to make more money.
That's right. That's right. And capitalism can function, but right now it's not functioning. And this is definitely, we have this late stage of a speculation boom, and that's when things get really out of whack. And when we see the corruption of our political system, I mean, that's why I'm running, right? Because I'm a historian. I teach history at Columbia. I'm not a politician, but I'm just so sick of watching the sellouts, right, of every group. Melissa Mark Vitorino, another potential candidate for public advocate, who sold out East Harlem, right? What's going to happen to the Puerto Rican community of East Harlem now that it's been rezoned? Well, we're already seeing the disappearance of Puerto Rican-owned businesses.
Right. But what does the city get? I mean, I look at the Barclays Center and that whole, what is it called, Pacific Park now, I think it's called now.
Mm-hmm.
They haven't paid city taxes, nor will they, for quite some time because they're paying off the bondholders. So the Barclays Center has been there for how long now? Eight years? And that one dime has come to the city. How does the city benefit from any of these projects if we're doing away with taxes?
Well, they always find community leaders, so-called community leaders, to come out and say, this is what we want, these are the things we're going to get, these are the concessions we're going to get. But somehow, it never transpires, the improvements never come to the schools, the improvements never come to the infrastructure. And so that's why we as New Yorkers need to be wise about this. See who the real enemy is. And understand that when some front man from Rebney comes into your community and says, go along with this rezoning because you're going to get concessions, don't believe it.
Yeah. Let's try to throw a few more things that Rebney's behind. We're familiar with the Independent Democratic Conference, the IDC, and we've got most of their members who are holding up rebuking Rebney. Ones that are out there just got won some of the Democratic primaries. Rebney was the major bankroller of the IDC. They bankrolled the IDC. Why? Because they wanted to control the Republicans in the New York State Senate. They weren't concerned so much about social issues, okay? They were concerned about economic issues. And what Rebney wanted to make sure was we can continue to weaken rent stabilization laws. We want to get rid of rent stabilization completely, number one. And number two, we want the billions of dollars of tax abatements and subsidies, what we call corporate welfare, continue to flow from the taxpayers into big real estate. And those are two key things, and that's why they bankroll these groups of Democrats to vote and caucus Republican. They'll stand up there on social issues, they got no problem. But you want to know something? If you're not good on economic issues and people can't afford to pay their rent, they can't buy food, etc., doesn't matter how good you are on social issues, people can't survive.
That's right. And by the way, day after the IDC was ousted and they lost, what do we see in the reports and cranes? Rebney is already at it trying to create a new IDC, IDC 2.0. It'll have a different name, a different brand, yes. But they are working to create the pro-real estate coalition with Democrats and Republicans.
And you can be sure the governor will go along and he'll maneuver whatever he can to make that happen. The one thing I liked about David when I met him, because I saw David speak at a rally. I think this was after the election was actually over. He was out there speaking, you know, as a populist. And I went over to him, I said, David, I hope maybe we can work together, even though your candidacy is over because you lost in the primary. I said, man, you know, you're fighting for the right things, okay? And one thing David said, he said, and I'll run again. Why? Because I want the public advocate's office to be what we real public advocate. We want to stand up and really fight for the public. And not just, and you know, this goes, there are many things we talk about fighting for the public. And one thing that's dear to my heart, and I'm glad that David's behind it too, is the concern of animal welfare issues. And this gets into real estate. Right now you got the real estate interests trying to prevent a major animal welfare center from being built, okay, in the Bronx. The Bronx and Queens are the two boroughs that have no animal welfare centers. Now, we know how many people love their pets, cats, dogs, whatever, okay? You lose a pet in the Bronx, and it has to be shipped into Manhattan or somewhere else at a center that's already overburdened. Thousands of these animals are euthanized. Can you imagine your pet being euthanized because there's no place to perhaps protect them? Or you look at all the strays that are out there, the animal centers, just like the ASPCA, the Humane Society, where you try to bring in these feral cats, for example, and neuter them and put them back out in the wild. But you don't kill them. My God, these are domesticated pets. Yeah. As some people realize, pets are like your own children.
That was an issue that came up in Industry City, where there was a bunch of cats that were being fed, and they hung around Industry City. And when they started to build up, the neighbors were concerned that they were going to be euthanized.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And cats can be, feral cats can be used for rat control. Mm-hmm. Right now we have a killing industry,
yes,
of poisons, which we are putting all around the city, and we don't know the health consequences, yeah, that these poisons that we're putting out for rat control are going to have on people, on New Yorkers long term, particularly children. Right, so we are killing the feral cats. We are shutting down these animal shelters for real estate interests, and the city has to get smart about how we are dealing with animals.
Right.
And it right now it is a kill policy, exactly, instead of a smart policy that could actually result in better health conditions for animals and people.
One of the issues in this neighborhood in particular are raccoons.
Yes.
Now I grew up 5 minutes from here, I said before, and we never had raccoons. But suddenly, we have raccoons all over the place. If you come back here tonight, there's a family of five raccoons that come into our yard at night. And recently, I think in the last 2 weeks, the city started dropping poisons from helicopters across Brooklyn.
Okay. All right.
Now, what the hell is that?
What the hell is that, right, Mike?
They must. They're probably doing it to Central Park too, because you got a lot of raccoons in Central Park. This is ridiculous.
You know, look. This. They do not care about the health of people. Their priority is somebody who's making a lot of money on these poisons being dropped on our city. You don't know when you drop something from a helicopter. You don't know where it's going to land, right? And this is again a conversation what is the impact on the animals, and what is the impact on the people? And this is a conversation that will not be had because a public advocate has been working in cahoots with the mayor. And until we have a public advocate who will actually stand up for the public, we are going to have, you know, silence on so many of these issues.
And what this also leads in, by the way, into what the health department and everything does, just like when we talk about what's going on in the NYCHA housing, okay, what the Department of Buildings is doing, all right? All these interests seem to be together, and there's a pool of money that they're going to keep for themselves. They're not going to do what you're supposed to do, like make sure NYCHA housing is livable. Okay, make sure the things we're talking about, that we create a natural system, not a toxic system of the environment. So these are very critical issues that they don't want to talk about.
Right. Did you see the article in the news recently about the mayor and his wife were talking about Flint, Michigan, and they were donating money to Flint, Michigan, as the story was coming out about NYCHA?
NYCHA, in which here is are these public buildings in which we are poisoning the children. Right? And what was the mayor's approach? First deny, then lie, and then blame it on Mike Bloomberg.
Yeah. Right? I honestly think that NYCHA is a racist approach to public housing. I mean, the city doesn't give a damn about anybody in NYCHA, and they prove it by doing nothing.
That's right. That's right. And if you looked at the waste, fraud, and corruption in NYCHA, right, you would be able to find the money to do the necessary repairs, right? But all the politicians look the other way.
Right, so a good public advocate will be out there advocating for those people in the NYCHA homes. And that's what I saw in David. And that's why I was also drawn to his candidacy on that. Let's talk about Rebney on the labor issue, okay? We talked about the, Rebney is 100% anti-union. They're the ones that, to be a member of Rebney, 80% of their members, they must pay dues in order to be able to work for these big brokerage firms. They have to pay dues. If they don't, they can't work for the brokerage firm. That is called a closed shop in labor movement. On construction sites, you have what's called a closed shop if everybody on the site is a member of a union. Mm-hmm. Rebney has broken all that closed shop up. They wanted nothing to do with closed shop, yet they themselves have a closed shop when it comes to all these agents having to pay dues to Rebney in order to work at the brokerage firms, okay? You got Hudson Yards. You got demonstrations that have been going on for a year at Hudson Yards. Yeah. Well, who's developing Hudson Yards? The big developer there is Stephen Ross. Stephen Ross and Bruce Beal, who's part of the related companies, okay? They believe that construction workers are pampered and grossly overpaid. Now, that's coming from Stephen Ross, who's worth $7.6 billion. And his wife, who has an expensive jewelry and exotic handbags and things she sells from animal skins. Let Peter know about that, okay? I mean, yet at the same time, construction workers are grossly overpaid and pampered. There's something wrong with this.
We are back to Gilded Age attitudes, in which you have this class, the upper class, looking down on everybody else and seeing us as just pawns in their little game. And then you got these politicians like Tammany Hall back in the Gilded Age, and now Bill de Blasio's administration that has totally sold out. They pretend like they're pro-immigrant, like Boss Tweed, right, with the Irish immigrants, and Bill de Blasio today, but they're not. They're sellouts.
And you know what happens? The way the politicians work, when you look at the big thing about what we call corporate welfare, these billions of dollars of tax abatements and subsidies to the big real estate interests, people like Bill de Blasio and other sellouts to the real estate industry, political people, they would like to be a billionaire. They would like to have that wealth. They want to at least be rubbing shoulders and being part of the team. But as long as they go to the billionaires and say, we will keep all this big tax abatements and subsidies flowing to you, then they get these huge campaign contributions. It's a good deal. You know, it's a damn good deal for a big business to say, we'll finance your campaign no matter what it takes. You just make sure that you keep that money flowing to us. Right. Because they make
out. That's why I mentioned that one of your rallies, in fact, it was outside the last Rebney meeting, where, to me, you can take money out of politics, but that's not enough. You have to have recall laws to be able to pull those politicians back when they're doing something that the community doesn't want.
Exactly.
So, to me, recall laws are just as important as taking money out of politics.
Recall laws, but in order to pass those recall laws, you got to get rid of the politicians.
Yeah, well, you have to go through the assembly.
And this is very important. Now, you know, as Ray mentioned, I ran for public advocate against Tish James in the Democratic primary. I got 92,000 votes. I spent $57,000, which is about 50 cents per vote. To give you a sense, Andrew Cuomo spent $27 per vote in his last election. So, you know, if I can get, you know, a bit of support from people, if you believe in this idea that we can take back our city, if you can go to my website, publicadvocateeisenbach.com, contribute a little bit of money, and come out to vote for this special election. It's going to be very low voter turnout. It's going to be highly informed, highly motivated voters who are actually going to show up for this thing. That should be sometime in February or March. We can take back the city from these crooked politicians.
And also go to the website StopRebneyBullies.org. Being the real estate bullies of New York, ravaging every borough of New York City. They're doing such great harm to this city. And again, when we talk about organized labor, there is an attack on labor by the Real Estate Board of New York. There's an attack on tenants by the Real Estate Board of New York. There's an attack on small businesses by the Real Estate Board of New York. We have to get rid of the Real Estate Board of New York. So you can also go to the StopRebneyBullies.org. Believe me, we can use your contributions there as well to fight against the Real Estate Board of New York. We need to put justice in business and put the Real Estate Board of New York out of business.
Because remember, it's our city, not their city.
That's right. Now, going to your site, the back of that brochure, you've got all of the city council members.
Yes.
Now, I'm sure we all want anyone listening to call those people and tell them that we want the laws the way we want them.
Yes, what we've got here is, this is, they can go to our website, stoprevenuebullies.org, and you'll find this leaflet, which focuses on the monthly disappearance of thousands of small businesses, local jobs must stop. You can download this in both English and Spanish. On the back of the leaflet is all the city council members and their contact information by phone and email address. We're asking everybody right now to contact the city council members and say, we want the Small Business Job Survival Act, SBJSA, passed intact, not watered down. We want three things. David, what are the three key ingredients that in the
guaranteed 10-year lease renewal to all small businesses in good standing? Two, legally binding arbitration to settle all rent disputes between landlord and tenant. And three, no pass-alongs, no water bill pass-along, no property tax pass-along to the commercial tenant.
And let me add one other thing. I just have to sneak over here and grab a bag. We've talked about this, but let's just bring it up. This is the famous brochure. Thousands of these have been distributed. This is what so many courageous political leaders or people running for political office, including David, by the way, on our website, holding up this brochure that says, beware of Revney, real estate bullies plague in New York. You can download this from our website as well.
And make sure you turn out for the rally at City Hall, October 22nd at noon for the Small Business Job Survival Act. We need everyone to turn out for this right now.
Right, and come early because you got to go through security. So you might want to come at about 11:30, no, certainly no later than quarter to 12 to get through security, to be on the steps of City Hall for the rally, and then to go into the hearing that starts at 1 o'clock. And by the way, people can sign up and speak. Okay, we'd like to have as many small business people there speaking, but anybody can go and speak and stand up for their neighborhood. Just go in and sign up, because if even it lasts for hours and hours and hours, we need as many people. This is a chance. If you don't get it passed now, it may be another 32 years before you get another chance.
Here's a question now that I'm thinking of Sunset Park. A lot of those people are immigrants. They're not going to want to come out and speak because they're afraid. I don't blame them. Do you know of any organizations that are coming out?
Yes, we have many organizations, including the Hispanic Chambers of Commerce. But we just urge you, right, now is the time to take the stand. The reason why so many, particularly immigrant small business owners, are afraid is because the landlord will take revenge on them and will target them and will not offer them the 10-year lease renewal. So we have to pass this law, the Small Business Job Survival Act, right now, because it will guarantee the 10-year lease renewal to all those immigrant store owners throughout the city.
You know, a lot of your listening audience were people from Occupy Wall Street, okay, stand up and fighting for the 99%. Well, everybody out there who's been part of the Occupy Wall Street movement, think of, you don't have to come in and sit down, but please come to City Hall, come to the rally, go into the chambers, fill all those seats, just be seen, okay? And sign up and speak and just stand up and say, we want to protect our small businesses. We want to pass the Small Business Job Survival Act intact, no watered down. And any city council member who does not vote for it, we're going to hold you accountable. You're going to go the way of the dinosaur.
Great. Okay, I appreciate you guys coming today. And we'll get the people out there to call their representatives and to follow your websites and make this all happen.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.